We're going to SD 43.7, chapter 7 of Sutta Discovery, volume 43. Now this sutta is a very important sutta. It's a very unique sutta about skillful means. You might say this is the locus classicus, the key reference in early Buddhism, in early Buddhist texts on upaya or skillful means. The title of the sutta is Arahata Nanda Sutta. The title is simply Nanda Sutta. Well, because there could be other Nanda Suttas, I've given the prefix of Arahata in front of the title. Arahata means Arahathood, how Prince Nanda, the Buddha's half-brother, becomes an Arahat. So the English translation is the discourse on Nanda, brackets, Arahathood. Udana 3.2, And the theme is Nanda overcomes sexual lust. Now, as we know, the Prince Siddhartha, our Bodhisattva, when he was born, or rather 7 days after he was born, his mother, Queen Mahā Māyā, passed away. And he was taken care of by Queen Maya's sister, in other words, his aunt. She became the foster mother. Now, her name is Mahā Pajāpatī Gotamī. She, her own son is called Nanda, so she let the wet nurse take care of Prince Nanda, and she herself raised the young Siddhartha. So Nanda and Siddhartha, they are very close. Siddhartha, of course, is the elder brother. So here is a story about how he became a monk in the first place. Yeah? The first part is quite humorous, actually, and then it gets a bit serious and becomes very spiritual. And there's a lot we can learn from this sutta in terms of human emotions. The sutta doesn't tell us how the Buddha got Nanda to become a monk. The story is found in the Janapada commentary. The Buddha was in Kapila Vattu, and on the very day of Nanda's wedding, all those celebrations, kind of housewarmings, probably has a new house, is getting married, and Buddha goes to his house. He has dana, there is given alms food. And after finishing his alms food, he passes the bowl to Nanda. In other words, he's getting Nanda to carry the bowl for him. And Nanda obliges. And the Buddha walks back to his residence, Nanda falling behind. So here's where you have a layman. You might call him Pacha Upasaka, if you like, the layman who attends the Buddha. And they both arrive in the vihara where the Buddha and the monks were staying. Then the next question the Buddha asked was kind of crucial. The Buddha asked him, you might even say almost casually, Nanda, why don't you become a monk? And Nanda, without a thought, at once replies, okay. Of course, we're wondering, you know, how come Nanda so quickly and so easily replies and agrees to become a monk just like that? It was his own wedding day. You know? We must remember, it is a royal family. And then this Nanda was probably, 18 years old? 20 at the most. So, and those were early years of the Buddha's ministry, right? So you might say the first 10 years, or even the first 5 years. So Nanda, being the younger royal brother, obviously felt obliged. And this is called the noblesse oblige. Né? In other words, royalty, they feel obliged when the senior asks them to do something. So he says yes without a thought, not of deference or respect for the older brother. Or maybe a young person could just think, say, maybe it's fun to try and be a monk perhaps. But anyway, he decides to become a monk. He says, yes, so he gets ordained. Okay, so the story starts from there. The sutta continues from there. So let's look at page 112. Is that correct, the paging? The discourse on Nanda, Arahatur, U3.2. Thus have I heard at one time the Blessed One was staying in Anatta Spindika's park in Jetta's grove outside Savatthi. Now at that time, the Venerable Nanda, the Blessed One's brother and his maternal aunt's son, informed some monks thus, "Also, I live the holy life unhappily. I am unable to keep up with the holy life. I would like to give up the training to return to the low life." Okay, so he's unhappy, right? So this, and very soon you'll know the reason why. Then a certain monk approached the Blessed One and saluted him and said this to the Blessed One. He repeats the whole thing, what Prince Nanda had said just now. So what the Buddha says, okay, summon Prince Nanda, the Venerable Nanda over here. Say the Buddha, the teacher summons him. So Nanda comes along. Now this part is very important to see how the Buddha questions a monk. He doesn't assume anything. Although he stole, Nanda feels like this, so he asks. Okay, let's look at section 4. Okay, section 4, Nanda summons the Buddha summons Nanda. Nanda comes along. And then 6. He approached the Blessed One, saluted him, and sat down at one side. Seated thus at one side, the Blessed One said this to the Venerable Nanda. "Is it true, Nanda, that you informed some monks who saw I lived a holy life unhappily and so on?" He's not happy being a monk. And then Nanda says, "Yes, Bhante." Then the Buddha asks, "But why, Nanda, do you live the holy life unhappily, unable to keep to the holy life, and would like to give up the training to go back to the low life, or just to the lay life?" Then, okay, now we know the exact reason. Nanda says, "The Sakya lady, Bhante, who is to me the country's beauty, Janapada Kalyāṇī, with her half-combed, looking on as I was leaving the house, said to me, 'Please return quickly, young lord,'" Ayaputta, young lord or young master. So here we have this very graphic image in the monk Nanda's mind. He still remembers the last moment as he was leaving his home. The lady he was going to marry, probably 16 years old, standing, looking out through the window above, upstairs, and saying, "Young lord, please return quickly, because it's your wedding day." Okay, so the conversation ends there for temporarily. Surely there must be other words, other speech, other talk going on, but here, for the sake of a flow of narrative, we are given the details. Okay, the next part is a miraculous event, if you like. Now we can interpret what happens next even as a kind of either it really happened out there, that's one way you can look at it, or it's happening within Nanda's mind, if you like, a kind of vision, a kind of epiphany, if you like. Then the Blessed One, grasping the Venerable Nanda by the arm, and just as a strong man would stretch out his bent arm or bend back his stretched arm, even so they disappeared from Jetta's grove and appeared amongst the devas of the 33. Now imagine here, the Buddha is bringing Prince Nanda to see the devas, not of the form realm here, because Nanda doesn't have any meditative powers, so he's not able to see those high gods in the form realm, but the sense world is not too difficult, right? So here the Buddha brings him to a different dimension, so to speak, to the realm of the heaven of the 33, to see sakras, apsaras. These apsaras, they are often depicted in Chinese cave paintings, even in paintings in India, beautiful, even voluptuous, if you like, fairies, heavenly beings. They are just there for pleasure. They're happy beings, dancing, singing all the time. So there are 500 of them. Okay, so now at that time, some 500 apsaras or celestial nymphs had come to attend to Sakra, the leader of the devas, and they were dove-footed. I'm not exactly sure how dove-footed looks like, but there are some paintings in Thailand, for example. I suppose you have some idea if you look at the legs of doves and imagine that they kind of become extended in size to fit a human being. So in the ancient Indian mind, when you talk about beautiful legs, that's how it looks like, something like that, okay? I don't think they look exactly like in a scaly like a dove's legs, but rather a kind of maybe smooth and leggy, as we say, okay? So they were basically beautiful, attractive. We're talking about heavenly beings. I mean, you can think of the most beautiful girl on TV or in the movies on earth, but these heavenly beings even more beautiful than that. In fact, we will get a very good idea of this in a moment. There's a part here, an episode which is not mentioned but implied. That is, apparently, when the Nanda and the Buddha were kind of flying up into the sky, so to speak, the Dhammapada commentary says that they kind of flew above the Himalayas, up the Himalayas, and then there was a forest fire there, and there was this monkey who was singed, burnt, nose burned, kind of burnt up monkey looking very ugly. And so Nanda saw this, and then they go up to the heavens of the 33. So, okay, this is the fun part now, the beginning of the skillful means, right? 11. Then the Blessed One addressed the Venerable Nanda. Do you, Nanda, see these 500 dove-footed nymphs? Okay. So, Nanda says, yes, Bhante. What do you think, Bhante? Which is more beautiful, fairer to behold, more charming? The country's beauty amongst the Sakya? In other words, the beautiful woman that Nanda is going to marry? Or these 500 dove-footed nymphs, alright? Then Nanda replies, just as the singed monkey, singed means burnt, singed monkey without ears and nose, Bhante, even so, is that country's beauty among the Sakyas when compared to these 500 dove-footed apsaras? So you can imagine the kind of mind that Nanda has got into now. His mind has switched from that of missing a loved one to being delighted. Okay, so then they say, wow, look at these beautiful girls. Okay, so we're talking about a late teenager, like 18 years old, 20 years old perhaps, sexually fixated to girlfriends, going to marry, and being a young man, even a young boy. Like, he sees this beautiful heavenly devas or these apsaras. Obviously, he will kind of respond in this way. It's very natural, even though he's a monk, but he's not ready to be a monk, in other words. So he says, he compares to the woman on earth, to the one he's going to marry. He says, well, if you compare her to the heavenly nymph, she looks just like a monkey. You know, these divine beings, divine apsaras are so beautiful. And then he continues, he says, she comes not into any consideration at all, or even by a fraction, there is no contrast at all, so no comparison. Okay, so he's kind of, suddenly he seems to have forgotten how beautiful the girl is, and he says, wow, look at these heavenly names, it's so beautiful. Now we must really understand the context of this story. What the Buddha is doing now is flooding the mind of Nanda. In other words, giving Nanda exactly what he wants, showing him exactly what he's thinking about, and imagine a scenario where he's going to get it, in other words. Now, the other psychological implications of this, I found the notes here, right, so you can find an introduction. What page is that? REBT and so on. Section 2, 3, 2, 1. I mean, you can even explain this kind of procedure that Buddha is using in today's psychology as rational emotive behavior therapy, for example, the method of rational emotive imagery. In other words, Prince Nanda is seeing exactly what he is dreaming about, this idea of a beautiful girl and so on. So in a sense, you might say this prince is marrying very young. So the Buddha is kind of getting him out of that situation, so to speak. Anyway, so what happens next is even more interesting. So the Buddha makes him an offer, gives him an offer. So this is the skillful means. The Buddha tells Nanda, section 15, delight in it, Nanda. Delight in it, Nanda. Now usually these sort of words are very out of character for what the Buddha to say. The Buddha will never say this in teaching the Dharma, right? This is the closest the Buddha comes in terms of skillful means. There's no lying here. Here the Buddha is saying, okay, you delight in this. These are beautiful things, you know. This skillful means later is going to be very fully developed in Mahāyāna when you find untruths are being used. For example, in the famous or one might say notorious parable of the burning house, where it is an old, big old mansion is burning and the children for some reason do not want to come out, although the house is burning. I mean, it's very strange that if a house is burning, people do not know about it. I mean, he's a rich man, there are servants, there are people, and the house of panic, you know. So we are given the idea that there's this big house, and all the children are there, and the house is burning. So it's not odd, actually. So this rich man calls the children, he won't come out. So obviously, these children wouldn't listen to the father. Anyway, it's a parable. So the father says, okay, I've got some beautiful cards here, you know, I've got three kinds of cards, why don't you come out? And apparently it's like, say, hey, you know, father comes back and says, I got you some new computer games, you know. And so all these children run out. But then when they came out, he didn't see any cards, and there was only one card, and there were no computer games. So that is lying. So the storyteller is telling us it's justified, because here we were talking about this teacher who's trying to save the lives of these kids. So even lying to the kids is all right. But any intelligent young person, a young student might say, why can't a father just shout, fire, fire? If the kids hear that, they probably be curious, father, what are you doing? And they'll come out and they'll see the fire, you know. So these are things we must be ready, the responses we must be ready to at least answer. So that's skillful means in the Mahayana and later Buddhism. But here we see a classic use of upaya, where it is very effective, no lies, but just kind of a step-by-step procedure. So, okay, this is what you want, okay, this is what you're going to get. So, the Buddha says, delight in it, Nanda, delight in it, Nanda. I will be your surety in that you will win this 500 Dafuta Apsaras. Okay, I'm your guarantor. I will tell you, you're sure to get it. Again, this is very uncharacteristic of the Buddha, but why the Buddha is saying this? Because he knows, we know, this will never happen. But Nanda is the only one who does not know. Okay? So to that extent, it's a skillful means in the sense that the truth is suspended temporarily for the sake of this young man to have his vision, his own private, selfish, sexually fixated vision come real, so to speak, in a deluded mind. Then Nanda says, section 16, if Vanted, Blessed One is my surety, I will win this 500 da-foot absurance, then I, Vanted, will delight in the holy life under the Blessed One. See, okay, that's fine, okay, I'll remain a monk then. Because you see, here, what's humorous is, you have an opposition of two contradicting things, you know. I mean, he seems to forget that if you're a monk, you cannot really enjoy all these divine beings, even if they are yours, right? He doesn't think about that. So that's humor, see, where you see this contradiction here. Then the Blessed One, grasping the Venerable Nanda by the arm, and just as a strong man would stretch his bent arm or bend back his stretched arm, so he appeared back in Jetavana. Now the monks had done, okay, now you have a bit of sociological situation. Nanda's, the monks, and especially Nanda's friends hear of this. And Nanda becomes embarrassed. Okay, look at 19. The companion monks, now this is very important to know, companion monks, and was Nanda's good friends. He is a young monk, remember, so he has other young friends. The companion monks of the Venerable Nanda began to address him with the word hireling. Did I miss out a paragraph?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, 18. Yes. Sorry, go back, 18. Now the monks said thus, it is said that the Venerable Nanda, the Blessed One's brother and his maternal aunt's son, lives the holy life for the sake of apsaras. The Blessed One, it is said, guarantees that he will win the 5 da-footed apsaras. So here you see the Buddha's humor at work. And the companion monks of the Venerable Nanda began to address him with the word hireling, pataka, and the word one who is bought, upakitaka. Okay? Now, these are not slander or spoken in a nasty way. You might say these are teasing words. Okay? Teasing words, hireling. In other words, you're hired, and you have been bought over by someone. Okay. It's also a play on word here, because one who is bought is also describes a slave, by the way. So you know, he's a slave to his feelings, to sexuality. The Venerable Nanda, it is said, is a hireling. The Venerable Nanda, it is said, is one who is bought. The Venerable Nanda, it is said, lives the holy life for the sake of apsaras. The Blessed One, it is said, guarantees that he will win those 500 da-footed apsaras. Then the Venerable Nanda, okay, now something happens. Here we see a different kind of process taking place in the mind of the one who is going to get awakened. Here is a gentle process compared to, say, the conversion of Angulimala. Or even Wakali. Okay. In a sense, it's dramatic compared to, say, Wakali's process of conversion. Of course, Wakali's conversion is dramatic in the sense that it was actually a suicide, or attempted suicide, it's going to jump off a cliff. But here, it's not so dramatic compared to that, say, Wakali's suicide attempt, but it's dramatic in the sense that it's happening in Nanda's own mind. And he himself is able to see, beginning to see something's wrong here. So we can relate to this better, in other words. So it's described very beautifully here, what happens in Nanda's mind. And this is very important for us to spend a bit of moment reflecting on this section. Section 20. Then the Venerable Nanda, being troubled, ashamed, disgusted, with being called hireling, and one who is bought, dwelling alone, aloof, diligent, exertive, and resolute, in no long time at all, right here and now, having realized it for himself through direct knowledge, attain and dwell in the supreme goal of the holy life, for the sake of which sons of family rightly go forth for the household life into homelessness. So at once, when you see this kind of paragraph, you know Nanda is going to awaken. So here, we said a very quick change. There are lots of things going on in between, but here you have the gist of the story. Then the narrator continues. He directly knew birth is destroyed, the holy life has been lived, done what is to be done. There is no more of this state of being. The Venerable Nanda became one of the arhats. So he becomes enlightened. Okay? So happily, you might say this is a very easy way of getting enlightened. Even someone who is in love could be enlightened. Someone who was a serial killer became enlightened. Someone who was sexually fixated on the Buddha, Vakali, also was free from his emotions and became enlightened. There is hope for everyone. So this is the climax of the story. Okay? Now you see Nanda, the Arahat. Remember, there are some things which are still not resolved, right? Some promises the Buddha made. So the story continues. Section 22. Then when the night was far gone, in other words, it's like between 10 to 2, very peaceful moment, a certain devata of exceeding radiance, exceeding beauty, there should be a comma after radiance, lighting up the whole of Jeta's grove, approached the Blessed One. Having approached and saluted the Blessed One, he stood at one side. And standing there at one side, the Devata said this to the Blessed One, Bhante, the Venerable Nanda, the Blessed One's brother and maternal son, has right here and now realized for himself through direct knowledge, upon attaining the liberation of mind and liberation by wisdom, that are influx free with the destruction of mental influxes, dwell staring. So here, in other words, this is a long way of saying he has become an arhat. Then the knowledge arose in the Blessed One. Nanda has indeed become an arhat. Okay, so the Deva disappears, and then Nanda comes along. Probably it's the same night, you know, the Deva appears and goes away, and then Nanda comes along. 25, you see the timing is the same. Then when the night was far gone, the Venerable Nanda approached the Blessed One. It's possible here the Deva appears, say, between 10 to 2, and Nanda appears, say, after 2 a.m. perhaps. The Buddha normally would rest between 2 to 4, so probably come before that time. Or it could be early in the morning, 4 o'clock, which is unlikely because...
Is it night far gone, that means it's morning
already? When the night was far gone, early morning, It's possible early morning. Maybe when the Buddha has just got up, that's another possible time. But in both cases, the night was far gone, you know. So usually when you see the word Abhikantaya Ratiya, it's usually between 10 to 2 when Devas will appear to the Buddha. But in the case of the second mention of the same phrase, it could apply to, say, before dawn, say between 4 to 6. Anyway, still early in the morning for us. So that then, in other words, after the Deva has left, then Nanda comes along to see the Buddha. He probably must have just come out of his meditation, exuberant, happy, bright with awakening. 25, next line. Having approached and saluted the Blessed One, he sat down at one side. Sitting thus at one side, the Venerable Nanda said this to the Blessed One, Bhante, I hereby release the Blessed One from the agreement in which the Blessed One is my surety, Bhante, as regards the obtaining of the 500 tough-footed apsaras. So he says, I free you from your promise, because I don't need the money. Okay? Then the Buddha replies, I too, Nanda, have known your own mind with mine, that thus, Nanda has right here now become an arahat. And then and the devata too has informed me of the same matter, that you are an arahat. Then the Buddha says, 38, indeed, Nanda, just as your mind is free from clinging, released from the mental influxes, I too am freed from the agreement. So what the Buddha is saying here is that even if Nanda doesn't vocalize, doesn't say it, it's automatically the promise is null and void, because the promise was made before Nanda got enlightened. The promise was made to Nanda as an unawakened lustful monk. But now you have Nanda, the arahat, the awakened monk. So in a sense, a different Nanda, if you like. So, and the kind of promise doesn't work on an awakened monk, an arahat. It wouldn't make sense, because an arahat wouldn't want any apsaras, he has no more desire. So the Buddha says, even if you don't say it, you know, I mean, effectively saying, but even though you don't say it, it will still be the case anyway, all right? So here we see the nature of skillful means here. In other words, what the Buddha says to Nanda is for his benefit, reflecting on his own mind. But the Buddha knows very well this won't happen. So, because Nanda is going to get awakened, the time was right for him. So because of that, the Buddha owes him nothing, and he owes the Buddha nothing, so to speak. They're all debt-free. And debt-free is a very important term in the monastic life. We don't owe anyone anything at all once we become arahats. If we're not awakened, especially as a monk or a nun, we receive alms from the laity. We have to eat mindfully. Even if we do eat mindfully, we still live as debtors to those who have supported us. In other words, if we do not attain awakening, and we are not diligent in spiritual life, and the next time we'll be reborn as slaves and workers and inferiors to these people who have served us. Even as lay people, if you are full-time lay workers and you get supporters from others, and you don't live up to your work, what you're going to do and what has inspired the lay people, then you have a great debt to return to them. You become their servants and slaves in the next life, maybe in this life itself. So if you're a full-time lay Buddhist worker, Dhamma worker, you have to be sure that you are doing your work as a lay Dhamma worker. You're doing your practice, you are doing your teaching, and you will work hard for awakening in this life itself. So the story closes now on a very happy note. Section 29. Then the Blessed One, knowing the significance on the occasion, uttered this Udana, inspired utterance. Yasa nittino panko, madito kama kandako, mohakkhayam anupato, sukha-dukkhesu na vedati sabhikkhuti. For him who has crossed over the Maya, who has crushed sense desire's thorn, who has reached the destruction of delusion, that one trembles not before joy or sorrow. Right? So, for Nanda, joy or sorrow, whichever one, doesn't matter to him anymore, because he has conquered delusion. So, this is the beautiful story of skillful means and Nanda, which we should reflect on.
Yeah.
Yes?
Ask a question.
Sure.
The devata. Is the devata enlightened? How can he know that Nanda has become arahat?
Yes, this one was very interesting accounts in the suttas. We often find devatas coming along telling the Buddha so-and-so is enlightened, accepting arahatthood. Yeah, this is quite a problem here. One possibility is just a guess that the devatas have made. There is a possibility though that the devata could have been awakened. You know? I mean, we do not know. I mean, it could be enlightened, this devata, but it's not mentioned. Another explanation could be maybe the Devata is watching Nanda meditating, and from the way this Deva is, from the way Nanda is meditating and his radiance and calmness, this Devata could have guessed that he was awakened. A fourth possibility is that Nanda himself could have told the Devata. These are some possibilities. But we get this kind of account very often, often enough in the suttas. You remember in the Adipatthaya Sutta, where the Buddha tells these people who do wrong secretly, he says, "Oh, foolish one, why do you do all this bad stuff in secret? You think the world would not know it, but you yourself know it, and the Buddhas and the Devas will know it." So there are some, the Devas or Devatas probably who are psychic, who's able to sense this. And there are also accounts where you find Devas, they are able to read the Buddha's mind, and they more or less know what the Buddha is going to do and so on. So these are moments, I'm not saying all the time, but there are moments when you find the Devatas could like know what's going on. I don't think they can read the mind really as good as the Buddha does, but it's just like maybe we ourselves, when we look at someone, we have some idea of what this person's thinking, what's going to do, something like that, I would say. And these are very special moments, key moments of awakening and so on. I suppose it wouldn't be too difficult to know, especially these devas, that if they are good devas, if they are themselves in some way practicing. Or otherwise, there is a last way. We can take this simply as literature, as a narrative, trying to tell us to how to overcome sexual desire, that there is hope even though we are caught up with lustful fixations, things like that. So all these details are just narrative details, they're just stories. Just like we read a good novel and we are inspired to live a happy life, a good life. Okay? Alright, so we end here. Let's do our short reflection. Today we have reflected on the story of a very important person in early Buddhism, Prince Nanda. How he, despite his sexual difficulties and fixation, is able to overcome them all through the Buddha's help in a way. Through the some help from the Buddha, and with a lot of effort on his own, through his meditation, through his reflection. You might say he's ready, but he's been distracted for a while. So when he goes into his meditation, he could easily awaken. And we too, in many ways, can be ready if we let go of negative aspects of our lives and let the positive and good aspects ripen. Reflecting in this way is very good karma. By the power of such karma, may we be well and happy in this life itself. May the Dhamma always be there for us to help us meditate, get stillness of mind, and even awakening in this life itself. To the various good deeds we have done, to our faith in the three jewels, and our practice of various good deeds, by the power of all the good karma we have done, may we aspire to attain at least stream winning in this life itself. In this moment of peace too, let us share our loving kindness to all the beings here. May they be well and happy. And to all our loved ones and friends, may they too be well and happy. And if they are lost, may they return to us and rejoice in our friendships. And also let us send our loving kindness to all other people we have known, that they may be well and happy, especially those whom the Dhamma have not touched, that they may see the Dhamma and awaken to their own efforts. May all beings be well and happy.
Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.